Good morning. So it is my pleasure to introduce Radu Laza from Stony Brook, who will tell us about the remarks on degenerations of K-trivial varieties. Radu, please.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation. It would have been nice to be in Miami to see friends and get away from the kids, but that's what it is. Okay, so just to fix the notation so I will discuss about K-trivial varieties. For me, this means that the canonical class compactifications such that the canonical class is trivial. As it is well known by Bovil Bogomolov decomposition theorem, they come into three basic types: complex tori, Hyperkaehler manifolds, and strict Calabi-Yaus. So complex tori, degenerations, and everything is kind of understood. We'll focus today on the simply connected case, the Hyperkaehlers and the Calabi-Yaus. Hyperkaehler, just a quick recap. So it means simply connected, and there exists a unique holomorphic symplectic to form. On the other hand, Calabi-Yau in this talk will mean strict Calabi-Yau, meaning no holomorphic form except middle dimension. Always when you talk about these things, you should give an example. And as it happens, in dimension two form is n form, so there is only one case, the K-free surfaces, which are well understood, and I don't think I need to recall anything about that to this audience. So basically the question is, what can we say about degenerations of such things, Hyperkaehlers or Calabi-Yau? So in that situation, I'll consider a one parameter family. And I want to say something about the limit Hodge structure, about the structure of the central fiber. And another question, kind of the global version of that, can we use these degenerations to understand compactifications and such? And of course, given the subject of the conference and my work, the main tool would be the period maps and Hodge structures, limits of Hodge structures. Briefly, the plan for today is a quick recap of the K-free situation. This is, super classical. I think everyone here knows the story, but it is used to set up the table for the rest of the talk. And there are kind of some small newish things at the end of section one. So maybe there is something of interest. I guess the main beef of the talk will be in the second part, where I'll discuss about the generations of Hyperkaehlers. And here, if you are interested in details, you should see my two papers, the first one with Kohler, Saka and Boazan, and more recently, the one with Green, my student, Yonjo Kim, and Colleen Robles. And the general story here is that whatever holds for K-frees eventually would hold also for Hyperkaehlers. There is a small twist at the end of the section two. There is something new compared with K-3s, or maybe something new. And finally, hopefully I will get there. I will discuss, and this is the most interesting part of the talk, is speculations about Calabi-Yau free folds. Unfortunately, the current situation intervened, and whatever progress here was slow. So, but hopefully next talk that I will have something more substantive to say there. But this last part secretly is related to the main theme of the conference. Not exactly O-minimality, but why the O-minimality is important from my perspective and all of that. compactifications, the completions of period maps, and so on. And this is related to my work with Philip Margreen and Colleen Hopeless. It also relates with work with Matt Kerr, where we care about the limit mixed Hodge structure and the relation to the central fiber, where we don't assume normal crossings. And this probably is also related to what Mihnea Popa discussed on the first day. So basically the idea is that if the central fiber is relatively mild, is singular, then you can get some restrictions on the limit mixed Hodge structure. Okay, so let me start discussing about the situation for K3 surfaces. Just to set up the notation, I'll work in the polarized case. I'm taking K3 surfaces. I'm allowing singularities because I want to impose, from a moduli perspective, it's better to ask for polarization, not quasi-polarization, but there is a price to pay. You need to allow canonical singularities, you need to allow AD singularities. If you do this one, you have the Torelli theorem. I mean, it's more than Torelli, but the main theorem here is that the moduli space is a locally symmetric variety. This Hermitian symmetric type, the domain of type 4 in Cartan classification, gamma is arithmetic acting on D, and you have a nice isomorphism of quasi-projective varieties. On one side, the moduli, on the other side, the period space, as we like in this conference. Now, it's important to note that this is an isomorphism of quasi-projective varieties, but not an isomorphism of stacks. What's going on is that here you have the reflection hyperplanes, you have Picard-Lefschetz transformations where you get a different stack structure than on the other, but that's something a bit technical, and let me just skip. Okay, so we are interested what happens with a one parameter family of K3 surfaces. And second of all, can we use our understanding of one parameter degenerations to compactify the moduli of K3 surfaces? Okay, so here there is a fundamental result, which I guess is more than 40 years. So this is around 1980. So the Kulikov person Pinkham, which basically says that if you have a degeneration of K3 surfaces, it can be arranged by a range, and this would come over and over in my talk, means that you are allowed to do base changes and birational transformation. So it can be arranged to be simultaneously semi-stable and minimal. Semi-stable, of course, holds in general. You can always achieve this one, quite generally by MAM for that all. And minimal, you kind of achieve by NMP. But it's something magic that you can achieve both of them simultaneously. The importance of this thing is that once you have this situation, this is kind of Kulikov model. Once you have this situation, you can classify the central fiber. So I want to get to Calabi-Yau, so let me just make it very brief. So the upshot is that there are three types of degenerations. The types are according to nil potency index of the monodromy on H2, and you have a classification of the central fiber. Type 1 is smooth, type 2 is whatever, is a chain of surfaces. The important thing that I want you to note here is that the dual complex is an interval. In the first case, the dual complex would be just a point. And in the type 3, the dual complex would be S2. And another thing that I want you to pay attention here, when you do this, when you try to classify this thing and you do a junction and all of that, you see that in all cases, there exists a Calabi-Yau core. So let me not make a precise definition, but okay, in the type one, the Calabi-Yau core is obviously the K3, the smooth K3. In the type two, the Calabi-Yau core would be this elliptic curve, which is kind of the same elliptic curve showing up several times. They cancel somehow, and there is one elliptic curve. In the type three, the Calabi-Yau core is like a point. So what I mean by Calabi-Yau core, when you do the computation and the junction and all of that, you'll see that most of the stuff is rational, or more precisely, uniruled. And there is at the end of the degeneration, kind of the deeper stratum, which carries the holomorphic form. So the holomorphic form in the end comes from a Calabi-Yau, and depends how deep it goes, and that's the Calabi-Yau core. Okay, so this is what I was saying. And so the dual complex, and of course, one consequence of the Kulikov theorem is the properness of the period net, and this is an important net. Okay, so the one parameter situation is very well understood. How about using this situation, the one parameter situation, to compactify the moduli of polarized K3 surfaces? I mean, the thing that's the problem here, and why the situation is not as good as, say, for curves or other situation, is that this Kulikov model is far from unique. So you can always do further birational transformation, what are called elementary modification, and you get a different model. And it's hard to see what is the canonical model and how to fit them in multi-parameters. Okay. If we talk about compactifications, the starting point, and I mean, my point of view is that whatever compactification you do about for K3s, it has to start from the canonical, minimal, and natural compactification that exists from the Hodge theory perspective, namely the Satake-Bailey-Borel. So, given that FD is a type 4 domain modulo gamma, Bailey-Borel theory applies, and you get a nice compactification. The problem from a geometric perspective is that this is too small. Basically, the boundary consists of a bunch of modular curves which are called type 2 components, and some type 3, which are just points. So here is the picture in the smallest degree. In degree 2, you see that there are basically four curves meeting in a point. So this is the boundary of the Bailey-Borel compactification. And of course, this is kind of a one point compactification in some sense. So this would not reflect the geometry of degenerations and whatnot. The ideal answer, we know what we want. The ideal answer would be to have some toroidal compactification which has geometric meaning. And we have a good example here, the case of abelian variety. So there is the result of Manford, Namikawa, and Alexeyev, where if you take a specific toroidal compactification, you get geometric meaning. Unfortunately, I'm pretty sure that nothing like this will hold for K3 surfaces, and people tried, and there is a long story. There is a lot of progress in the past 10-15 years, and let me just briefly explain what's the status and that one. So, I mean, I talked with people from the 80s that work on this problem, and from their perspective, the basic difficulty was the combinatorics of type 3 degenerations. So our understanding of the combinatorics of type 3 degenerations, or rather what kind of structure we should associate to type 3 degenerations, improved recently. I mean, there is a paper of Konsevich and Soibelman, maybe in early 2000 or something like this, where they I mean, it's more of a speculative paper, or I mean, it has many ideas, and I mean, the theorems are a bit hard to understand what exactly they say. But anyway, so basically, the idea is that instead of type three, you have a richer structure, an integral affine structure on S2, even a Monge-Ampère manifold. You have also a metric. This comes from metric perspective to degeneration, this kind of Gromov-Hausdorff limit and all that story. And this was, there was a lot of development starting from Honsevich and Soibelmann. So this started around 2006-07 and goes on and on. There is still not a complete answer in terms of compactification. Kind of a, I mean, at first glance, it looks different, but is quite related. So a different idea is to look at pairs. The problem, if you have something of general type, surfaces of general type, or anything of general type, you have this KSBA theory for general type, compactifications for general type. The K3s are K-trivial, so it doesn't quite apply, but you can apply that if instead of a line bundle, you choose a divisor in the linear system given by the polarization. And if you do this one, you have a different moduli problem, because you go from 19 dimensional, the moduli of K3s, to 19 plus G, D is 2G minus 2. But the good thing is that here you have a good compactification, which is geometric. So here you have a K3 pair compactification. So you have a geometric compactification for a closely related problem. Now, I mean, maybe the best result in this direction is my paper from 5 years ago or something, where I explain it, where I gave in detail the degree 2 case picture here. I mean, in general, this exists in general. The question is, what's the relation to Bailey-Borel and all of that stuff? Even more recently, there is the work of Alexeev and his collaborators. What they did was in low degrees, you can choose a section of this PG bundle. So basically, this means you choose a canonical divisor. I mean, it means that for each degree 2K3 surface, you can choose a specific divisor, namely kind of the ramification divisor. And it turns out that if you do this pair perspective, because you go to log general type and that, together with this canonical divisor, you actually get a nice answer. Sometimes it's toroidal or close to toroidal. So this is very good, but before you get too excited about this, the point is that this depends on the choice of section. I mean, for degree 2K3s, you kind of have a natural choice of divisor kind of that's coming from the double cover, from the ramification. But who knows, maybe you have another choice of divisor that will give a different compactification and that. Okay, long story short, I mean, I spent a number of years on the subject. Let me give you my take on the subject, on the compactification for K3 subject. So I think the actual correct geometric compactification is the SLC compactification. So you allow all smoothable degenerations of K3s that have SLC singularities, semi-low canonical singularities. The problem is, because you are in the K-trivial situation, you'll not get a separated moduli space, you'll get some sort of arcing stack, but I think there is a good moduli space. And furthermore, this compactification, this SLC compactification, will map to the Bailey-Borel, and it will be some sort of semi-toric compactification in the sense of Luyenga. And I know this is okay, or I mean, it's almost completely written down. In degree two is Schach in the, I don't know, 1980s. And the degree four is surprisingly difficult. And this one is maybe myself and O'Grady, maybe 2017 to 19. So basically, at least in the lowest two degrees, I think there is a good geometric compactification, and this is kind of everything comes together, kind of a Hodge theoretic perspective, case stability perspective, and even this MLP perspective. And for the purpose of this talk, I should say also that we should rethink the Bailey-Borel compactification and say that in the K-free situation and in the Calabi-Yau situation more generally, this is actually a good compactification. The point is that this is natural and additionally is mildly singular. I mean, it seems hard to believe it's mildly singular, but in fact, appropriately considered, is low canonical compactification, so kind of like the border of MMP, what they consider good. So this is mildly singular from that perspective, and you can do birational geometry on it. This was my perspective of O'Grady. And the key point from my perspective here, what is the Bailey-Borel compactification doing? It's not geometric, but it encodes exactly the Calabi-Yau core. So remember the picture for the degree two situation. You have here you have a bunch of type two components. So the type two components, there will be a number of them, but they correspond to, I mean, the discrete part, the fact that you have four of them reflects the combinatorics of the degeneration. And points here basically are the J invariant of the elliptic curve. And of course, in the type three case, the Calabi-Yau core is a point. So basically all the type three degenerations are squashed down to a single point in the Bailey-Borel compactification. But I think this perspective is actually should be very good perspective for Calabi-Yaus and so on. Okay, I'm about to move on to Hyperkaehlers. Let me just take a brief pause and see if there are any questions or anything. Okay, so let's go to Hyperkaehlers. So to start, I mean, to start, let me recall what are the known types of Hyperkaehlers. Basically, they all come from symplectic surfaces. So basically, all the known types are constructed in kind of an obvious way from K-frees or abelian surfaces. So there are two infinite series, the K-free and the Hilbert scheme of points on a K-free, somewhat similar, the Kummer N. And then you have two exceptional situations, the O'Grady 10 and O'Grady 6, which are obtained by desingularizing the moduli space of sheaves on a K-free surface or on an abelian surface, respectively, so a special case of moduli space. From the perspective that we are discussing here, the key point, the key fact is that the second cohomology comes endowed with a natural quadratic form. I mean, for K-frees, the quadratic form is obvious, it's just the intersection pairing. And in higher dimensions, you do something which looks strange at first glance. You integrate a class, so this would be in H4n, it will be a number, and then you take the root n. So the magic of the situation, and that's specific for Hyperkaehlers, is that this is actually a quadratic form. And the whole subject is based on the fact that the Hyperkaehler is controlled by the second cohomology. So in particular, Torelli holds. So appropriate form of Torelli holds. So if you know the whole structure on the second cohomology, you essentially know the Hyperkaehler manifold. Similarly to the K3 situation, you have a period domain, which again is type 4. The dimension is, in the polarized case is B2 minus 3. And generally the slogan is whatever holds for K3s will eventually hold also for Hyperkaehlers. I'll put here kind of a theorem, I guess, from last year or something. So it was a folklore theorem, I guess, and it was written down in the end recently by Odaka and Oshima, which tells you that the moduli of Hyperkaehlers with canonical singularities, again, I'm insisting on canonical singularities and ample line bundle, is isomorphic with a locally symmetric variety. This is exactly the same theorem as in the case of K3 surfaces. This is kind of the smooth case, if you want. I should have put this theorem later on, but it kind of fits nicely with my slogan. So this follows from Torelli, and one needs also a result from my paper, the KLSB, the theorem one that I will mention in a minute. So this is the properness of, so Torelli is kind of the injectivity of the period map, and the other one is essentially the surjectivity. Okay, so what can we say about degenerations of Hyperkaehlers? So remember, when we talk about degenerations of K3 surface, the main theorem, the theorem that makes everything work, is a Kulikov person Pinkham. So the higher dimensional analog is much more recent. I mean, it's kind of some sort of corollary of the big MMP package, the BCMH. So basically what it says is that if I have a degenerations of Hyperkaehlers, then I can arrange to be simultaneously minimal and DLT. And actually here, you'll see when I will talk, so this theorem actually, it's about K-trivial varieties. So here I don't need the Hyperkaehlers. I mean, this works for K-trivial, even numerically K-trivial and all of that. So this is almost as good as Kulikov person Pinkham. What does it mean, DLT? It means almost semi-stable. So essentially it's like a semi-stable situation, but you allow some mild singularities. I will not give the definition and I will not say much about this, but you have to think about the situation when you have a family of K3 surfaces with, say, AD singularities. So that would be a minimal DLT family. I mean, the point is that in that situation, you do the Briscoe semi-stable simultaneous resolution and you get a smooth family in the end. And similarly, you can have a family of K3 surfaces and you can allow some mild singularities along the double curves. And again, after base change and birational transformation, you can arrange it to be smooth. Okay, so you have something almost as good as the Kulikov-Person-Pinkham theorem. And again, similarly to the K3 situation, you have a natural notion of type. So the type in this situation is the same definition as before. You take the index of nilpotency on the second cohomology. In particular, just to make clear what it means, type one, it means finite monodromy on H2. This is important. Okay, so the first theorem that I want to mention here is the following. So if I have a type one degeneration of Hyperkaehlers, then I can actually arrange to be a smooth family. So in other words, I can get away from the Kulikov situation, from the DLT situation, and really get a strong Kulikov for type one. And I mean, this is very good. In particular, it gives the properness of the period map. In particular, is the key ingredient in this theorem of Odaka and Oshima. So let me note, however, and I mean, maybe someone is interested, so this is actually open. I mean, I strongly believe that for Hyperkaehlers, there is a strong Kulikov theorem for type 2 and 3 degenerations, and the argument should be pretty similar to the type 1, but yeah. Okay, so this theorem one comes out of two theorems. A theorem A, the monodromy theorem, which actually uses only kind of K trivial, and the theorem B, which is kind of specific for Hyperkaehlers. And I mean, okay, so let me put them here. So theorem A says that if I have a minimal DLT degenerations of Hyperkaehlers, the following are equivalent. Finite monodromy, canonical single, so the family has finite monodromy. The central fiber, this is equivalent to the central fiber having canonical singularities. This in turn is equivalent to the central fiber having a component which is not uniroot. I mean, kind of two and three are almost clearly the same, but three has the advantage is kind of stable with respect to the usual things that you do when you do birational transformation, kind of the semi-stable reduction. So three is kind of like, doesn't really depend on being minimal DLT. Two depends on the minimal DLT condition. But the key result is, of course, this equivalence here. I'll say in a minute how that comes about. And theorem B, it says that if I have a minimal DLT and I have the condition two or three, then the family can be arranged to be smooth. This is, as I said, this is Hyperkaehler specific. So just to emphasize, this cannot hold for Calabi-Yau free folds. I mean, what's happening for Calabi-Yau free folds is that if I have a degeneration such that the central fiber is Q factorial and has terminal singularities, no matter what I do, I cannot improve the situation. But for Hyperkaehlers, basically you can make it smooth. And you should think about the make it smooth being the equivalent of having a family of K3s with ADE. After base change and simultaneous resolution, you can make it smooth. Here, what I want to emphasize, I mean, the key point in theorem A. So theorem A gives you an equivalence. Basically, what is theorem A? It relates the central fiber, the singularities of the central fibers, of the singularities of the central fiber have canonical singularities to the type of the degeneration, to the degenerations having finite monodromy. And the point here is that DLP singularities are low canonical. This is known that these are Dubois singularities. Maybe here you can do also rational. I haven't checked. I think maybe it works with rational as well. Anyway, so and here, once you have Dubois singularities, what's happening is that the natural specialization morphisms between the central fiber and the limit Hodge structure gives you an isomorphism on the frontier Hodge numbers, and then this allows you to control the finite monodromy in terms of the singularities. Basically, if you have worse than canonical singularities, you show that the monodromy is infinite and converse. Theorem B, okay, let me skip that one. This is specific for Hyperkaehlers, and it boils down to deformation theory of canonical symplectic singularities. Okay, so just to repeat, the type one degeneration is as good as it gets, is basically same as smooth family. Now here, I mean, let's go to kind of genuine degenerations. Let's go to type two and three degenerations. I mean, there is something to be said here and all of that, but let's focus on the type three degeneration. Let me say something about type three, and let me say only about the dual complex. So the dual complex, first of all, makes perfect sense. So the dual complex normally is well defined for semi-stable, but in fact, this is what I'm saying here. It makes perfect sense to define it in the exactly the same way for DLT. So DLT, remember, is basically semi-stable, but you have some sort of very mild singularity here and there. And those singularities from the perspective of the dual complex, you just ignore. And furthermore, Kohler, Defernix, and Shu show that if you have such a degeneration, minimal DLT degeneration, the dual complex is in fact a well-defined topological invariant of the degeneration. So it is natural to ask what can we say about the dual complex of type three degeneration. This is the interesting case. Remember, for K3s, the dual complex is the sphere in the type three case. So it turns out that type three degeneration is equivalent with MAM degeneration. This is a simple but non-trivial lemma. It uses something from Verbitsky, and I will come back from a different perspective in a few minutes. So let me not dwell on it too much. I mean, just to understand what's going on here, the type three degeneration is about the nilpotency on the second cohomology. The maximal unipotent degeneration is what people in mirror symmetry do all day. So it's about the nilpotency on the middle cohomology. So a priori, I mean, there is no reason, and I mean, if you have maximal potency on H2 to be equivalent to maximal nilpotency on the middle cohomology, but this is the case for Hyperkaehler. So what it says, this one, I mean, just simple consideration, it tells you that the dual complex has real dimension 2n. So the dual complex would be 2n dimensional. And here is our second theorem. Is if I have a maximal unipotent degeneration of K trivial varieties, then basically the dual complex would be a rational cohomology sphere for Calabi-Yau and a rational cohomology CPN for Hyperkaehlers. I mean, I think this was kind of folklore. I mean, of course, you expect much stronger. you expect is not only rational cohomology, you expect to be on the nose SN or CPN. And here is basically the status of this, this thing. In dimension two, it is known that you get S2, which happens to be the CP1. So dimension two, the starting dimension is good, good both from Calabi-Yau and Hyperkaehler perspective. In dimension three, it is known that the dual complex is S3. This is a non-trivial result of Kolar and Shu. For dimension four, Calabi-Yau case, this is conditional. I mean, you assume something, and then you conclude that the dual complex is S4, and this is a result of Kolar-Shu. I think the same condition and the same type of assumption and the same type of tools will actually give you that in dimension four, the dual complex is CP2. And I think this would be okay, provided that you have a strong Kulikov for type 3 degeneration in dimension 4. So if you are able to prove that a type 3 degeneration in dimension 4 of Hyperkaehlers can be arranged to be simultaneously semi-stable and minimal, then I think it follows relatively easy that the dual complex would be CP2. And why is this relevant? Why do you care about this one? It's because one possible approach to understanding the classes of Hyperkaehlers. So this is a big open question. So what are actually the Hyperkaehlers? I mean, we have four examples so far, are those all and so on, even in dimension four. So one approach would be to study the degenerations. If you look at the type three degenerations, this is basically something very combinatorial, and you can hope that you understand the combinatorial object, and then maybe you can prove that in dimension four, the only ones are K32 and Kumar 2. And I think there will be a talk which sounds very interesting tomorrow by Andrew Harder in that kind of direction. So I think it's pretty important to understand this thing. Okay. And now I want to get to the Calabi-Yau. So let's keep moving and let's go to something that's actually new. Compared with K3s. So if you've paid attention, is all I've said so far is that the Hyperkaehlers would behave exactly the same as the K3s. Okay, so let's say something new for higher dimensional Hyperkaehlers. And this is the obvious thing. So for higher dimensional Hyperkaehlers, we have higher cohomology. So, and furthermore, the second cohomology determines X. So the second cohomology determines the Hyperkaehler. So consequently, the second cohomology determines all the higher cohomologies. So in the case of degenerations from the perspective of degeneration, the natural question to ask is, suppose that I have a degeneration and then I look at the nilpotency index on higher cohomology. So I have the nilpotency index on the second cohomology, which gives me the type. And what can I say about higher cohomology? This was first studied by Nagai, and the natural conjecture. I mean, here I will focus only on the even cohomology. The odd cohomology has a similar story, but kind of even and odd live in different worlds in this story. And So let and typically the only the Kumar N is known to have odd cohomology. So in some sense, the even one might be more important. Anyway, so the conjecture is that the index of nil potency on H to K is, what can it be? K times the index of nil potency on the second cohomology. So this was shown for the K3N by Nagai, and this is how he got there. And then for type 1 and 3, this was the content of, I mean, this was one section in our KLSV paper. So just to, I mean, this one, type 3 is what I mentioned earlier on. This is the same as saying type 3 is equivalent to MUM, and type 1 is saying finite monodromy on H2 implies finite monodromy on HK, on H2K, or even all that. So, and actually, you have to be a bit careful here. It's not, even if you know that in the type 1 case you can fill it in with to a smooth family, you still have to be a bit careful, because anyway, let me move on. So finite monodromy on H2, I mean, this is the Nagai conjecture. So Nagai conjecture would say finite monodromy on H2 implies finite monodromy on all H2K, and we proved this in the type 1, this is a type 1. We were going back and forth on the type 2, which seemed, I mean, in the end, it was not included in the paper because we couldn't prove it, and there is a reason why we couldn't prove it in the type 2, and let me just very briefly explain this. So it turns out that type 2 is actually a non-trivial condition on the cohomology of Hyperkaehler. So the underlying question here is, how is the second cohomology determining the higher cohomology? And the idea here goes back to Hengal, Lunds, and Verbitsky from mid-90s, is that you have hard left sheds, which gives you an SL2 action on the cohomology. But what is special for Hyperkaehlers is basically almost every class on the Hyperkaehler wants to be Kaehler. So because you can change the complex structure, you have lots of freedom, and basically, essentially, any class can be Kaehler. Almost every class can be Kaehler. So the upshot of this one is that you get putting all the Lefschetz operators and inverse Lefschetz operators together, you get a big Lie algebra, the LLV algebra, which acts on the cohomology of the Hyperkaehler. So this is a topological invariant. And long story short, there are two key facts here. This algebra generated by Lefschetz class, Lefschetz operators and inverse Lefschetz operators is nothing but the orthogonal, the special orthogonal algebra associated to the Mukai completion of the second cohomology. So you have the second cohomology, which is a quadratic space, as I mentioned earlier, and you add a silly hyperbolic space. So the hyperbolic space is like in Mukai, basically keeps track also of H0 and degree operator and all of that. So this is a very simple and real, I mean, you know it. And the second fact, which is the key fact that makes the argument, that makes the type 3 equivalent to the maximal unipotent, is the fact that the subalgebra generated, so I have the entire cohomology algebra, I can look at the subalgebra generated by H2. So this subalgebra generated by H2 from a representation theoretic perspective, if is nothing else than the symmetric n power of the standard G representation. I mean, here one has to be a bit careful. The Cn is not irreducible. You have to take the main component. So in other words, if you look at the LLV decomposition, you have G is a nice simple algebra and stuff. So you have a decomposition into irreducible pieces. And what I said above is that one piece here you always know is basically the Cn piece, which accounts for the cohomology coming from H2. So for K3 and K32, basically this piece, the Verbitsky component H star of X is this Vn. But in general, this is different. So you always have this Cn component accounting for cohomology of H2, but in general, you have many other components, who knows what they are and that. Now you can, these components, at least if you look at the even cohomology, you can encode them by some numbers, by a Young diagram and all of that. And the key proposition is the following. This is kind of the type 2 case. This is the type 2 case in Agai. This was what was missing from the KLSV. So it turns out that Nagai's conjecture is equivalent to this condition on the representations occurring in the LLV decomposition. So here, to appreciate this one, it is immediate to see that just by dimension reasons, you have this mu zero, the first row in the Young diagram has to be less equal than n, which is half the dimension of the Hyperkaehler. The next condition, we know quite a bit about the Hodge diamond of a Hyperkaehler. It has lots of symmetries and all of that. The next condition, this type of things about the Hyperkaehler, is that mu zero plus mu one is less equal than n. And it turns out that Nagai conjectures of the behavior under degenerations is the next condition in this, so kind of stronger and stronger. Of course, since I'm giving this talk, Nagai condition holds, and in fact, we have a very nice conjecture saying that. That not only mu one and mu zero, mu one, mu two sum up to n, but the sum of everything is up to n. So basically, the Young diagram that occurs in the representation has at most n boxes, and this has immediate consequences. For instance, boundness of the second Betti number. And essentially this one says that the Hyperkaehler is motivically obtained from a surface, which is maybe something to be expected since the Hyperkaehler is controlled by H2, you may believe it. In any case, the conjecture holds, obviously. This is why I'm giving the talk. The conjecture holds for the known cases. But of course, the point of the conjecture is that if it holds in general, you get nice consequences for all Hyperkaehlers. So we have no idea how to proceed. I have 5 minutes. Let me see if there is any question here or. Okay, are people still online or?
So are you?
Yeah, okay.
Are you done? Okay, let's.
Okay, so at some point you are afraid that your internet is out and you are speaking to the screen. Anyway, okay, so let me take the last 5 minutes the last 5 minutes to go to the Calabi-Yau. So this is work in progress, and I think there is a pretty nice picture here. And this would be closely related to the subject of this conference. So basically, I'm starting with a family of Calabi-Yau. So I have the Hodge numbers 1H1. So here I'm looking at the fur cohomology. I have the period map and all of that. Of course, the main point in this story is that this is a non-classical period map. Okay. So what one would like is to get a properness. I mean, I haven't seen this discussed. Maybe I'm ignorant of all the vast literature on Calabi-Yau, but a key question here is, can we make this period map proper? I mean, you always, when you have a period map, you want to get to Torelli, and you want to get some properness for the period map. And nowadays, because of the work of Brunebarbe, Becker, and Zimmermann, we know that the image of the period map is quasi-projective. Of course, you can always do a period map to be proper by what Philip did in the 70s. You can add, you can compactify normal crossing, take the finite monodrome divisors, and then you get a proper period map. But of course, the main point is that you want to have some geometric meaning of this partial compactification and that. And here is something that bothered me for a while. And if you read the KLSV paper, there is a lot of discussion about this doesn't work for Calabi-Yau and not. Basically, the story is that if I have a degeneration with A1 singularities, the simplest type of the ordinary double point, then you get infinite monodrome. But on the other hand, if you have a degeneration with A2 singularities, you get finite monodrome. So the paradox here is that the bad singularity is better behaved Hodge theoretically, while the very mild singularity is going to the boundary. How can it be? So you cannot get this MF to get properness of the period map. And what I realized while I was revising the KLSV paper is that the wrong thing is that, I mean, once you don't get the answer that you want to a problem, it means that you look wrongly at the problem. So the problem is that the finite monodromy is the wrong notion for Calabi-Yau. And the correct theorem is the following. So if I have a minimal DLT degenerations of Calabi-Yau threefolds, the following are equivalent. The monodromy is of Picard-Lefschetz type, is equivalent to X0 having canonical singularities. So PL monodromy means that you preserve the holomorphic free form. It means that the limit mixed Hodge structure is as simple as possible. So the point is that the holomorphic form stays in weight free. You have some degeneration, some n here going in the middle, but that one. And let me point out that this was known kind of the Yau school, where they show that this notion of Picard-Lefschetz monodromy is first of all is equivalent to finite Bell Peterson distance. So this was C.L. Wong, I don't know, 15 years, 20 years ago. And then 5 years ago, Tosati showed that finite Bell Peterson distance is the same thing as canonical singularity. So there is another perspective here. Okay, here there is the Picard-Lefschetz monodromy actually comes from the Lin and this Shimura type situation. Let me discuss it if anyone is interested. And let me finish with the global picture. So you actually can get a proper period map with geometric meaning for Calabi-Yau if you do the following. So you start with moduli of Calabi-Yau, you enlarge it to Calabi-Yau with canonical singularities, Calabi-Yau with canonical singularities. And you need to blow up, even in the simplest case, I can explain for people that are interested, maybe offline, you need to blow up the discriminant to normal crossing. So you have this canonical moduli and you need to take a log resolution of it. If you do that, then you get a proper map. And the point is that it will not go to the D mod gamma, but rather to a partial Bailey Borel type compactification. So you need to allow this finite Van Peterson distance, these degenerations of the type that I discuss above. And I mean, in GGLR, this is what we try to construct in general, a Bailey Borel type compactification with partial success. And I mean, there is a lot of work from people like Zimmerman, Bruno, and all the other talks in that. But the point that I want to make here is that what interests us here should be very nice and very easy in some sense. I haven't done it, but I mean, this seems totally doable. The point is that you want to do this Bailey-Borel type compactification, but because of the very special type of situation that you are in a situation very similar to AG. You are in a non-classical situation, but basically, it looks to me that this is very similar to the Bailey-Borel compactification for AG. Basically, you need to add to Calabi-Yau, you need to add Calabi-Yau with Koch numbers minus one, minus two, and so on, and you get some sort of nice stratification and all of that. And let me stop here and let's see if there are any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Radu. Are there any questions? Okay, then let's thank Radu for a nice talk. Very much. So we will resume at 10:15, 15 minutes. Okay.
Okay, thank you, guys.